me roll the windows up, which is something that I have not done in many, many years. And I am flooring it right now. Today, I am driving a 1983 Mercedes G-wagon, which is likely the slowest vehicle I have ever been in. But it is one of the most unique and cool, and probably one of the most rare ones in America, at least. So the G-Wagon, this generation, the first generation of G-Wagon ever, was never sold in America. They were gray market imported vehicles, which is one of these. There were a couple, I believe, that were like Department of Transportation, DOT certified, brought in, but those were really expensive. This thing was somehow made its way over to America. I believe the G-Wagon was launched in 1979. It's one of Mercedes' longest running continuous production vehicles ever. I mean, they still make the modern G-Wagon. I have driven several new G-Wagons, G63, G550, and I really want to see what similarities have been kept between 30 plus years ago and now. Well, performance has changed. That's me flooring it. 4-speed automatic transmission, 2.8 liter straight six. There were a lot of different engine options available. You could get diesels in them, but this one is a gasoline one. The brakes are extremely soft and sort of hold. Okay, I am stopping now. Whew. Okay. All right. So powertrain soft, 2.8 liter straight six. It's gasoline. They did introduce the gasoline injected vehicle or engine by this point in the lineup. 1983. It's been around for a while. This truck, I guess it's not a car, it's a truck, only has 77,000 miles on it. This is me flooring it. The speedometer kind of wiggles around a little bit. Now I'm doing it. And there's 30. Goodbye, rest of traffic. And there is an indicated 40 miles an hour and 45 at the speed limit. And it's quite noisy. This has an aftermarket hard top on it. Usually they came with a soft top. A lot of wind noise, but part of that's because this thing has the aerodynamic properties of a brick. As like the new one, the windshield is very vertical, the rear windows, the rear windshield, they're all just straight surfaces. It is literally a box on wheels. So cruising along at 45 miles an hour, I'm doing, oh boy, okay. So when the new G-Wagon, you can kind of wiggle the steering wheel around, like, you give it about like 30 degrees of input and it keeps tracking straight. It's the exact same in this thing. Nothing happens. The suspension is very soft, very loose. There is a lot of body roll. It kind of just jiggles around. When you take turns, and even at like 15 miles an hour, the whole truck is just leaning over, hit the brakes way early. I'm also greatly amused at the fact that looking out of this vehicle is the same as a brand new G-Wagon. It's the same shape of the hood, the same angle and everything. If I was ignoring the steering wheel and the dash and everything here in the dials, I would say I'm still driving a brand new G63. But then you put the pedal down, which is actually really hard. This gas pedal has a lot of resistance. Oh boy, that 4-speed automatic. It's got all the diffs and the transfer case and everything, which I'm not going to touch because I don't want to mess anything up. As would a brand new G-Wagon. And apparently it's decently good at off-roading. The owner of the car, Kyle, wants to restore the car, bring it back to it has a little bit of mechanical maladies that are plaguing it. But he wants to take it off-roading. He's messed around with it a little bit. He said it was a beast. It looks like a G-Wagon still. This is hilarious. If you talk exterior styling, like I said already, it looks like a box. It looks like a brand new G-Wagon. I swear the door panels, the hood and everything are the same thing, the same shape headlights. The same taillight design with a rear extra spare tire and wheel back there. The doors, which I love, still make the same sound. The brand new one and the old one, the solid, like, ka-chunk, like opening a safe door at a bank in a vault. It's such a solid feeling to open and close it. So this hasn't changed for generations of G-Wagons. The door handle looks exactly the same. And the sound it makes opening and closing is the same. Listen. It is aerodynamically horrible. It apparently will barely do 70 miles an hour, so we are not getting on the freeway. I came to Kyle. I told him not to come to me because it would be difficult to drive that far. On the inside, it's very basic. I mean, it's got these cloth. The seats are kind of ripped, so they've got these leather covers on them. But like, if you look at the design on the back seats, on the doors, it's the same cloth finishing. It's very, very spacious. I've got like tons of headroom above me. It's very open. It feels kind of smaller than the new ones do, maybe because it's lower or something like that, but I mean, all the dials and stuff are old, the steering wheel is very vertical, it's gigantic, It's a two-door convertible and it's white. So in certain key ways, this 1983 G-Wagon is exactly the same as my Audi R8. White, convertible, black top. They both have wheels. And I think the similarities end right there, though. Hello, Porsche. I'm going to try to make a lane change. Doing it. The steering is very vague. I feel like I'm just kind of communicating to this front wheels via a very old-fashioned input device. Oh my god. All right, we're gonna try to make a U-turn. I'm slightly terrified. The thing is, with a vehicle like this, you have to really guesstimate and guess ahead and look ahead for the space. Like when I'm used to with a faster car, when I'm making a U-turn like this in Michigan left, you can kind of decent size gap floor it and you're up at speed. This thing, you need a lot of time and distance to build up to the speed limit and follow the flow of traffic. All right, I can go now. Feel the power. Oh boy. Oh wait, the turn signals are still going. I want to talk about value briefly. These old G-Wagons, some of them aren't cheap. Some of them are kind of rare, collectible, especially if they're in good condition. Can be worth a decent amount. This one, I think we can confidently say, might be the cheapest G-Wagon in the country. This one was purchased for $3,500, which is crazy. It's only done 77,000 miles, which is not bad if you think about it for a 30-plus-year-old vehicle. The other thing is, though, the parts apparently are staggeringly expensive. The owner, Kyle, said, like, some of the things cost more than the car. Apparently, the OEM soft top for this thing is $5,000. The vehicle is $3,500. So he's like, make sure you buy a cheap one because you need a lot of money to fix it and upgrade it and do things to it, which is what he's planning on doing. So definitely not going to be the cheapest thing to own, but it's unique. I don't think I've ever seen an old G-Wagon like this on the streets before. I literally don't think so. Certainly, getting to drive it has been really cool. Miles an hour. And we're 40. I feel bad for everybody that's behind me right now. I'm sorry, this is very, very slow, but I've got a big smile on my face because this is hilarious. I personally am going to be very interested to see how the restoration of this goes with Kyle. And when he eventually is ready to take it off-roading, I definitely would love to check that out because I think that'll be hilarious. Like, hello, Jeep Rubicon. That's great for off-roading. This is more unique and more fun. Kyle said that it felt like it was, he took it off some dirt lots and stuff where they were in construction. He said it felt like it was never going to get stuck. It did fine. And I mean, the G-Wagon originally was like a military vehicle developed for that type of stuff. Right now, modern ones are pavement princesses. They never go off-road. They're designed for wealthy people to drive to the restaurant, to the steakhouse, and then go to the mall and buy some designer handbags and then go home. They are not utilized, even though they are still very, very capable. I mean, G-Wagons are still very powerful, but the thing is, like, they cost so much now, I don't think people would want to do that. Like, a friend of mine bought a Range Rover, and I was like, you know, I kind of want to get a Jeep for off-road. I'm like, we just bought a Range Rover. He's like, Eddie, my paint was $6,000. You think I want to scratch that up? I'm like, but Range Rover, it kind of makes sense, but it's also kind of like, come on. This thing, though, hell, I think it'd be hilarious to take it off-roading. On-road behaviors, if I'm honest, it's kind of terrible. It's horrible to drive. It's very loud. It's very, very slow. The brakes don't really work that great. The steering is just kind of guessing. You're just kind of turn the wheel. I'm like, all right, the wheels be like, the front wheels are like, I'll turn 25 degrees. You gave me 40 degrees of input, but we'll just do half of what you want. That's me flooring it. My cars. I will say the pros are it's very easy to see out of. Visibility is great. It is so just absurd and unique. It'll put a big smile on your face just from the sheer ridiculousness of driving this thing. The gas gauge on this vehicle is not working, so we hit the gas and we just put like 5 gallons in. Hopefully it won't go out. Other than that, this is hilarious. It's 4-speed automatic. I just left it in fourth. Just let us do its own thing. Not touching the transfer case. This is pretty dang awesome. Well, I don't know if I can make one summarizing complete statement about a G-Wagon for a review. I mean, it's kind of funny how certain things have really honestly stayed constant between one that's from 1983 and one that's in 2016 that's $170,000. They both don't handle great. The steering is vague and horrible. You got a lot of like body rolls. Suspension doesn't ride nicely. The pros are though, they both look badass, like a military vehicle that hasn't changed for decades. They offer the same chunky visibility and unique styling. I'm holding on for dear life right now as I take that turn. Oh my god, there's so much body roll. But overall, 1983 G-Wagon, first generation, imported into America, gray market. Now it was crazy cheap for the owner to buy this thing. It's probably the most unique vehicle I've driven. It is for sure the slowest vehicle I have ever driven. But it kind of shows that you don't need a million horsepower to have fun in a vehicle. This is a completely different way, a completely different experience. This is a ton of fun. I hope you guys liked this video. I had a lot of fun checking out this thing. If you have any questions, please comment below. Thanks for watching.